been inspired this week by a tweet that I saw that was reminding us that it's a good idea, if you're writing an extension method for a value type, so for a struct, that you should pass the this parameter, so the parameter that you're actually extending, by ref. And that's pretty good advice, but it got me to thinking on some of the ramifications of that and looking into it in a bit more depth. And so that's what we're going to be looking at in this video. Now, if you're not familiar with passing by ref, then I'd recommend you take a look at my earlier video that discusses that idea and then come back here and look at how it fits into this situation. But let's take a look at the sort of situation we're talking about. And so if we go over here, you'll see that what I've created here is a couple of data types exactly the same, except one of them is a struct, person S, and one of them is a class, person C, so a value type and a reference type. And apart from that, they're exactly the same. All they've got is a property called name that has a get and a set, and a toString that simply returns the name. So apart from being a class and a struct, nothing obviously different. If we then go to our program, I've created a couple of objects. So we've got our person as class, and I've got Alec class, and then we've got our struct as Lauren struct. So just so we can keep track, I've made those surnames the names of what we've got. But then I've put in some extension methods, which is what we're talking about. So if we go to this extensions file, you can see that I've got an extension method, again exactly the same for each of them, so for the class and the struct, and it's called Ennoble, and all it does is adds the word sir onto the front of the name. So in both cases, we just put sir on the front. So when we apply this, we should get Sir Alec class, Sir Lawrence struct. And so that's what we're going to do. So let's do that in our program. Let's print out the initial state of these. So we'll do our as class, and then we'll do our as struct. And then I will do the ennoble. So as class dot ennoble, there's our extension method. And similarly with as struct. And then we'll just print out a blank line and pop those results on the end. And if we run that, we get unexpected behavior, because although the class has added the sir onto the front, so Alec class has become sir Alec class, hasn't worked with Lauren struct. And if you understand anything about the way that structs, that value types work, that will actually make sense. Because remember, whenever we pass a value type as a parameter, then you get a copy inside the function. So inside our extensions, in the struct case, this person is a copy of the original as struct that we had out there. And so although we're modifying the copy, we don't make any change to the original. And that's the problem that we're highlighting here. So the simple thing to do is that we can just put the ref onto the parameter passing. And now it'll pass by reference. And so now when we run it, then we've got Sir Alec class and Sir Lawrence struct. So that's got it working okay. And that was basically the point that the tweet was making. Now, one thing that's just a little bit interesting to notice here is this is, I think, the only situation, I can't think of any other, where when you have a ref parameter, you don't have to explicitly repeat the word ref when you're calling it. So if we were to call this function in the normal way, so if I were to say extensions dot ennoble as struct, which would achieve exactly the same thing as using it as an extension method, but we've got to put the ref on the place you're calling it as well as on the declaration. But because it would just be so untidy in syntax terms, when you're doing it as an extension method, you don't have to put on there. So that's happening implicitly. But that's what we needed to have. Now, one restriction to put on this, of course, you only need to pass by ref if what you're doing in the extension method is actually modifying the struct that comes in there, which is what we have in this case. But if we changed it slightly, if we maybe made that return a string, and then rather than adding that on the end, we just returned sir and person name, then we could take off the ref, and then back here we could say var res equals, so that's just going to be the return string, and if we print out res, then we get the sir on both. So if you're not modifying the struct, perfectly okay to pass by value. It's only when we had what we had before where we're modifying it that we need to do that. And that reminds us of one of the good practices that is very often recommended when we're dealing with structs, which is that they should be immutable. So there should be no operations you can perform on them that can modify them, in which case this issue wouldn't arise and you could just pass by value. And in fact, the easy way to do that, which you may have seen, is we can simply, on a struct, we can nowadays declare the entire struct as read-only, and then you can see it starting to object because we have a setter on the name, and so we can remove that, and that's all okay. So that's one of the good practices, and this is an example of the reason why it's a good idea to make structs read-only, to make them immutable. But it's not an absolute rule of the language, so we have to cater for situations when they're not immutable. So that's the situation. If you're going to change it, pass it by ref. If you're not going to change it, you can just stick to passing it by value. But there is one slight further complication to this. One of the things I tend to generally do with extension methods is I like to extend interfaces rather than extending individual classes or structs, because it gives us greater reusability. We can see here, if we look at these two, they have a lot in common, and so why don't we extract that commonality and put it into an interface? So we'll just go to the class, we'll extract the interface. Don't need the toString, just need the name. And because the name is what we're dealing with, I'll call this iNameable. Click OK on that. And so it implements iNameable. If we look at the interface, it's what we'd expect, very simple. And then let's also make it so that our person struct implements that interface, and it just works OK because we've already got the name in there. Now, having done that, let's go to our extension methods. And rather than having these two enables, we should now be able to get away with just one of them. Because if we just have an enable that takes an iNameable, and rather than calling it person, because it could be all sorts of things now, we'll just call that nameable and pop that in there and there. And so now we should have managed the one extension method that works for anything that implements the iNameable interface. And if we go to our program, we can see that that looks happy. No errors, but if we run it, we're back where we started. We've still got Sir Alec class, but we've got Lawrence struct, not Sir Lawrence struct. And the reason for that is because when we now have our extension method, iNameable is an interface and is therefore a reference type. And when you pass a struct as a parameter to something that's expecting an interface, it has to box the struct, has to box the value type, therefore makes a copy, puts it in a box, and that's what's in nameable. If you're not familiar with boxing and unboxing, again, another video I'll put a link up to that explains what's going on there. But that's what's happening. So nameable, in the case of the struct, is once again a copy, and therefore we are not getting the behavior that happens inside a noble to happen outside. You might think, okay, let's fix that in the same way we did before. Why don't we just put ref on there? But we can see immediately there we're getting an error, because you cannot pass a reference type by ref. You're allowed to pass a value type by ref, but a reference type is always passed by reference, so there's no need for that keyword, and so that's what it's objecting to there. And so although that iNameable works for the reference type, it's not working for the value type. How do we get around that? You've got to do a little bit of trickery. And the way to do it is this. What we need to do is turn this enable into a generic. So we make it a generic over the data type T, and then just have T as the parameter. And then, of course, we do the other bit. We now put in a ref on that type T. And you can see it's complaining a lot, because there's two other things we need to do. We need to make sure that T is a value type so that we can pass it by ref. And we need to make sure that it implements the interface so we can get the name property. And we can do that just with a generic constraint. So I can put on here where T colon struct, so that ensures the value type. Now it's happy with the ref bit. And also that it implements the interface iNameable. And we can see that that is now happy. If we go back to program, we see it's working on the struct, but it's now unhappy with the class. We'll come back to that, so let's just comment that out. But now we should see that we are getting Sir Lawrence struct. So what's happened there is it has passed it by ref, because we put the ref in there, but it's also allowed us to have the interface. And as far as I can make out, that's really the only way you can do this, to have an extension method that takes an interface and will accept a reference to a struct that implements that interface. So that solved that problem, but as we saw, it's not working for the class now, because the basic reason, if we look at the error there, is just not complying with the constraints that say it must be a struct. So what we can actually do here is just copy that, and then all we need to do is firstly change struct to class, still not happy, but then also remove the ref, and now that seems happy. Because what we've got there is basically we've overloaded that enable. And a thing to be very clear about here, we have not overloaded it on the basis of the constraint. So the fact that that one says struct and that one says class is not allowing the overloading. It's the ref, or the lack of it, that makes that an overload, because ref is part of the signature, and so you can do it in those two ways. And so now, if we run that, finally, we've got everything working. We've got the class, the Alec class. We've got the struct, the Lauren struct. And just to demonstrate it's picking the right one, if we just randomly change the class version to Dame and run that, we can see it's picked up the appropriate one. So it's using those different overloads in each case. Now, actually, although you can do that with the overload of the generic, it's not actually necessary, because we could take the class version and make it much simpler by just going back essentially to what we had before. So if we just make it explicitly support iNameable, it's not a generic, so we don't need that at all, that will still work in the same way. So if we run that, we're still getting Sir Alec class and Sir Lauren struct. And that's because of the precedence rules that you have with overloading. Very nicely, it selects the correct one. So the reference type gets the one that just takes the interface, and the value type gets the one that insists that it's a struct and passes by reference. So that's solved that part of the problem. We can now have extension methods that work correctly, as far as we're concerned, for both reference types and value types, and that just pass reference types in the normal way, but pass value types, even through an interface, pass it by reference. Even so, we've still got some code duplication here. If you look at those two methods, the actual bodies of them are exactly the same, which is something you want to avoid. And you might think it would be possible simply to call one from the other and simply do something like this. We could say enable, nameable, and just to make it absolutely clear what's going on, let's say nameable as iNameable. Though we can see, because that gets grayed out, it's not strictly necessary, but just to make it clear what's going on. So we're passing from this enable into this enable. Looks okay, but if we run it, we've lost the sir again. We're back to Lauren's struct. And the reason is, although we've passed this nameable in by ref, as soon as we pass it again to the other enable, where we're passing it to the iNameable interface, it has to do boxing. So because nameable is not yet in a box, it's simply a reference, when you pass it to the interface, it gets boxed, and therefore now in here, we're dealing with a copy, and that's why we don't get the correct results. So slight drawback, I can't think of any way neatly around it, is that we do have to actually duplicate that code so that we're operating on the reference. And then that all works correctly. So quite a lot of stuff going on there, and I'll just summarize the rules that we've got there. But before I do, the one thing to bear in mind here is that although we've been talking about extension methods, everything applies here in pretty much exactly the same way to any method that takes an interface as a parameter, because that's all an extension method is. We're just, if you look at the code there, taking the interface as a parameter. And the fact it's an extension method is just kind of there to confuse us. All of these issues about copying, passing by reference, passing interfaces by reference would apply to any parameter, not just the this parameter. But let's go through some good practices, some rules. Firstly, wherever possible, make your structs immutable. Put the read-only keyword on. It's advised in lots and lots of places, and it's largely for precisely this reason that if you make a copy and modify the copy, you don't modify the original. So to avoid that, just don't allow you to modify it at all. However, if you do have to have a non-immutable struct, then the next best advice is, if you are not modifying it, well, you can just pass it as a parameter anyway, but if you are modifying it, pass by ref. And again, as I say, that applies both to extension methods and to any regular method taking a parameter. And then when it comes onto interfaces, which is where it gets tricky, because an interface could be an interface to a value type or a reference type, and we don't know when we're writing the method, the extension method that takes that parameter. So what we've got to do is, again, if you're not modifying anything, it's all simple. You can just have the interface even though you take a copy of the struct. But if you are modifying things, then you've got two options. Either you can do what we did here, which is to say you can provide the generic version restricted to the struct, which doesn't do the copy and passes by ref, or you can have the non-generic version that takes the reference type, and that will work in both ways. Or alternatively, you might just want to disable it entirely for the struct. And the way to do that is actually to go back to what we had with the generic version for the class, but then get rid of the generic version for the struct. And so now if we go back to main, we can see we're just not allowed to call it on the struct, and so that's a possibility. But if you've gone to that much effort, I'm not sure why you wouldn't have both of them in the two forms actually doing what you want. But the key thing to avoid is having just the non-generic version, because that's the really confusing one, because that's the one that will compile, but will give you what I think would be unexpected behavior in terms of missing off the cert. So, seems like a simple idea, but there's a lot of complexities to that. So I hope that's helped. If you enjoyed it, do click like, do subscribe, and I'll see you next time.